What's going on, everyone? So I tell you what's going on. This is part two of a series. So if you haven't seen part one, please look at the description and then check out part one first. Got this trabi out of Berlin, Germany, and it came into Baltimore. We picked it up in the last part, and now we're gonna try to fix it, make it ready for the trip.
And here's the little two-stroke engine. Originally, it was 26 horsepower. This one is a 30 horsepower, brand new engine. Came from Trabant from Zwickau. It's got a Mikumi carburetor, so the choke is a little bit different than on normal trabis. And I see these battery terminals, which I really don't like too much, but especially this one is a little sideways the way they installed it. So it's really close to touching the battery holder. So it's just basically 1 millimeter from shorting out and catching the whole thing on fire. So I'm gonna move this one a little bit sideways. It's tightened, so I'm gonna have to take it off. I just tightened up the negative terminal. And then we're gonna fix the door, because in the harbor they didn't know how to open the door and they broke the door handle on it. There's a little bit of difference between normal trabis and this one, because this one has a Japanese Mikumi carburetor. So consequently, the choke works a little differently on these engines. So normally on a trabi, you just pull it here and then it's like a round knob that you pull and that's the choke. But on this one, you got to pull it a little bit and then move it this way, and now the choke is on. And then when you want to turn it off, you just basically do this and the choke will go off. So that's the main difference. I really love this roof rack. It's well used, original. I have a really nice aftermarket one which my friend made me, but this one is just so authentic. I love it. Awesome.
The way we shift with this, now it's in neutral. If you push it down and down, can you push the clutch in please? With your left foot. This is first gear. This is second gear. You pull it out in third gear and then fourth gear. Does that make sense? So this is neutral, and the way we can go backwards is to push it through and then down. That's how we're gonna go backwards. Okay, before we start, we need to open the fuel. There's no fuel pump, so it's a drop tank. So we, just like on a motorcycle, we need to turn the fuel on. So this has to go down to the bottom. So this thing has to go this way. Would you do it really? Just go down, straight down, that's it. All right, now we got fuel, let's start it. Add the little gas, push the choke in, it's a little bit too much gas, but sure, start going backwards, and now you got to add a little gas to it, very nice, push the clutch back in, first gear, pull it back towards you, push it in, and
isn't that going to be third?
No. This is first, and you let the parking brake go, please.
That was on?
Yep. There you go, and then go around front of the 150. More to the right. There you go. And go in a big round circle around the 150. To the left. Oh, you wanted to go for a drive.
Oh, I thought you wanted me
go
to
go around the round pen.
Okay.
Don't hit this thing.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Let the clutch out. Let the clutch all the way out and add gas. All right, accelerate a little bit and second gear. There you go. First gear, you gotta
wait. No, I thought that's a reverse.
All the way down.
Yeah, that's all.
Brake, all the way down.
All the way down.
Now it's in reverse.
Okay.
All right, clutch in. Start braking. I'm gonna try to find what makes this sound, what a real bad rattling sound in the front.
Okay, stop it. Looks like we're gonna have to put it on the jack, on the lift, and then see where the it's most likely the exhaust is touching something. That's probably what's going on with it. But let's first fix the door on it. To fix this first, we're gonna have to remove this panel. The problem is that this thing got pulled pretty badly. They wanted to open it this way, but it's actually, there is even a sign says on it, but in the hardware they don't like to read. So we're gonna have to take this one off first, take this whole panel off with this, the two screws here, I think, yeah, two screws there. And then we got clips around it, and then we can see what's going on with it. It has these little clips, and we try to use the tool to unclip them right there. And we're gonna be able to put them back, hopefully, the way they came out. And then now we can access to this door handle piece. First, we're gonna roll the window back up to get more access to that part. So once it's up, we're gonna remove the two bolts for holding that door opener. I'm really excited that my son, William, took an interest in this. He's 16 years old, and most of the time he's in his room playing with his computers. So I'm really glad that I actually can see him doing something on a car, and it's not actual computer, and then he's gonna gain some lessons on how to fix something. So I guess maybe this will make him feel better too.
Washer on it too, there you go. And push it out, get it out, and see what happened. No, just there, what you did, that's fine. Looks like what happened was is that one of these little holders came loose. There is a washer there and then a rivet there, and then that came off when they pulled it pretty badly. So the only thing we need to come off with somehow to keep this where it's supposed to be and not to come off. We're gonna look for the washer, and we're gonna take this off so we can actually fix it on the vise or something.
I guarantee you that washer is still in the car somewhere, so there's a little magnet. We're gonna try to find it with it.
We couldn't find the washer, so what I figured out, I found the washer on my own, and what we're gonna do is we're gonna tap it, drill it, and then put a bolt in it, and that bolt will hold this washer in position, and it's gonna be a lot stronger than it was before. So now we're tapping the hole that we drilled, a little bit back, and then forward the other way. Yep, there you go, keep going with it. I had to put a little lube on it to make sure that the tap will work fine. After that, I cleaned it up with this, well, it's basically an alcohol spray to get the grease off of it. And then now we found the right screw for it. We're gonna screw it in and use some thread lock to make sure it locks well. And then after that, we're gonna grease the whole thing up and reassemble it.
Well, it's all in, and put the thread lock on it, which I need to wash off. But the main thing is that this washer is spinning on it, because this thing will have to move on it. So you can see it's full of thread lock. I'm gonna wash it off in a second. But the little washer is spinning, but the bolt is tight against that casting, and then we're just gonna cut off the excess on the other side because it's supposed to be flat.
It's done. Finally, it's working nice, greased up, ready for reinstallation. Everything is back on, very nicely working. I greased up the channels for the window as well a little bit, and then everything is fine. So the next thing we need to do is to properly finish off this side panel. So we're gonna have to position these ones to make sure they're properly there. Unfortunately, some broke, that's how it is with the Trabant. So we're gonna have to, whatever is missing, we're gonna redo it and then put this panel back up. The trunk was locked and the key was moving in it very badly. So I used my PB blaster to oil it up a little bit. So now it moves a lot better. And yeah, and look what's in there. Ooh, nice, some wheels for the desert, awesome. So now I'm heading to the DMV to try to transfer it and get a license plate for it. It starts with a sheriff's inspection. Then I got to show them the form where I'm requesting a title. And then I show them the insurance, what I already got. The entry requirement form, what shows that I paid the taxes or the $50 worth of duty, import duty on it. And then I got to show another paper that it's a EPA exempt car. So when you're importing a vehicle to the US, there are three regulations. One is the bumper, the windshield, and the emissions. So the bumper, I think it goes out on a, after 21 years old. The windshield cannot be a windshield that would explode on impact. This has to be a windshield that's laminated. And then the EPA regulations also gonna go out the window. Get an exemption from all three after the car is 25 years old. So I got all these exemptions and all these papers ready. And then a Kentucky application for title. I got the insurance. I got a official translation from the German title. And I think I have everything I need. So we start with the sheriff's inspection at first. And then he's gonna verify the VIN number. And then in the same building, hopefully I can get a license plate for it. I think the steering is a little bit loose, but not too much, but just a little bit. And I think the alignment is incorrect on it because I think it's too easy to turn the wheel to the left and the right, and it's just really not happy on the road. Well, we'll see how it works out. And then the heating is on. I don't know why the heat is on, and the heat is actually closed on it. So yeah, we'll see. We'll see what can I do with this thing, but let's first try to get a license plate for it, and then we're gonna address all these problems.
This is our Bourbon County Courthouse. It's a beautiful building. I always like to come here, and it's been burned down, I think, twice throughout its history, and every time it's been rebuilt. I'm always amazed how super nicely done all the details in it and stuff. I think this is the best DMV I ever been to, actually. So let's go down there and then check it out. There's never a line. There are no people here. When I was living in Houston, sometimes it took me like a half a day to do this thing, what we're gonna do in a couple of minutes here. So yeah, I love it here. It's just great.
It took me about 15 minutes to transfer the car. I got a really nice license plate for kids. And here is the license plate, cure cancer. I know this is not a cancer, what Katya is battling with. But I think this license plate is gonna look pretty good on the car. So now heading home and then trying to fix the problems that I found with it.
I put this little beauty on the rack. Unfortunately, there's a little leak from the master cylinder. You can see it there. And I think I just need to tighten up on this bolt that goes through the distributor. I think it's just leaking there. It's fine. And then when it came off the boat, somebody pushed it here on the exhaust, and that's why it was getting really close to the frame, it's not really the frame, it's a unit body, but it was touching there. So that's what I need to. I pushed it a little bit away, so now it's not touching anymore. The rest of the undercarriage looks really good, and I think it's gonna be fine. So I'm gonna have to do the alignment on it, hopefully tomorrow, because I think it's grossly misaligned on the front. There's a different alignment needed for the older bias ply tires, what this car came with, and the radial tires, what this car has now. So that's one thing I need to address.
I've adjusted a little bit on that steering rack. So there's the bolt right there. You can reach it from the top. You gotta be careful not to adjust it too much because it can go bad. So I just adjusted just a little bit, and you have to move the steering all the way out to one way or another to get a proper adjustment on it. Next thing I'm gonna do is fixing the heater. So when I turn off the heater, the warm air still coming in. As you see this little chimney pipe, well, not so little, this gigantic chimney pipe inside, that's where the hot air coming from around the exhaust shroud. And then it comes in, and as you see, this thing is not closing totally. If I could hold that light there. No, it's not gonna happen. So as you see right there, there is a little hole there. Like a little crack. So we need to make sure that this will go all the way down. So there's an adjustment on it to make sure that that goes all the way down. And that's what we need to do to make sure that the air will close on it. The fresh air will come through this pipe here. And then there's a hole in the front, and that's where this fake grill, that's where it's the fresh air gonna go in. So you can adjust it. There's an adjustment on the side right there. So this is what you're adjusting with. So I'm gonna need to unscrew this screw and make sure that that lever will properly close. That's a little adjustment I need to make on it. So I pulled out this bolt and adjusted on the cable. So my son is inside. He's gonna move it to the worm. So really do it. Yeah, see, now it moved it all the way out. So now the warm air will go inside the cabin. Okay, so close it now. So now it's all the way closed. and there's no air going in there. So I think that works. This is the end of the master cylinder. You can see the reservoir, and I tightened up that bolt and also tightened up the brake light switch. So hopefully it's not gonna leak now. So we're gonna probably, my son is keep pushing it, so there's nothing coming out. We're gonna take it for a spin and see if it still leaks.
Did you push the choke in?
Oh, no, I didn't. No.
That's why I quit. Push the. Okay, push turn it. Off the choke now.
Now it's starting?
Mm hmm. Stop and then first gear. We ran the little car out of gas because the German gas what was in it was not exactly the right one. Jean-Eric didn't put premium gas in it, so I had to change that to a premium gas because the engine was developing a little bit of the detonation. And then the other thing I'm gonna cure tonight is to glue this grease up properly. It looks like it was changed recently, but there was not enough glue on it. So the way you do this is you put glue on both surfaces. You put glue here, put glue there, and then you push them together and leave it there overnight. So I don't think that's happened. So that's the next thing I'm gonna fix before we go to sleep. We worked on a chart today to see what speed on the speedometer will correlate to 25 miles an hour, 35, 45, 55, and 60. 60 was just over 100 kilometers per hour on the speedometer, so that's pretty much the maximum speed you want to do with an engine like this. So even though it's a lot more horsepower than originally it was, I still wouldn't go faster than this with this little car. So I'm gonna make a little chart for him so he can follow the speed limits once he gets here. I brought this little Trabant out to our club drive. It was a perfect opportunity to try it one last time before Jan-Erik shows up and embarks on this 4,000 mile journey. The world is spinning fast tonight. Yourself trying to hold on to what you used to be. I'm so glad the past is all gone. Being out. Oh, Trip we just took, the engine was detonating pretty badly in the warm weather. So first thing I'm gonna try to do is to change the spark plugs. I don't know what kind of spark plugs are in it, but this is a really good summer spark plug from NGK. That's a B7HS. So we're gonna try to put two of them in there and then see if it improves anything, but I have my doubts. So as you see, this little air-cooled engine, it's two cylinders, two independent spark plugs, and it also has NGK spark plugs in it. That's good news. But yeah, let's see what is. It's a B8HS, huh? So that's a pretty hot spark plug in it. Yeah, I don't know that spark plug change gonna do anything, but nonetheless, let's try it. I just consulted with my friend in Hungary, and then he said this is the best spark plug this Trabi could have. The HS, that's the hottest one for the hottest temperature, and that's what we're gonna be up against when my friend's gonna go around in the Mojave Desert and Las Vegas and all these other places. So yeah, that HS would be good around 20 degrees Celsius, and then this one is basically on over that. So the only other thing I can do is lower the compression in it. So to mitigate that, they developed a new head gasket in Hungary. Just so comparison, this is the original one. That's what the factory put in, and then they developed a thicker one in Hungary, so this will be a better gasket for it. It lowers the compression just enough so that detonation will not happen. Also, I could increase the fuel going in there with that Mikumi carburetor. I'm gonna have to research that, so probably at first I'm gonna change the head gasket and then see if it's still doing something like that, and then I'm gonna probably trying to increase the fuel going in. To the fuel amount going in to richen the mixture in it.
That's the sound I'm concerned about. Stop.
It's absolutely really hard to record the detonation with the equipment I have, but you guys probably heard it that it does do it when it warms up. However, the German manufacturer who donated this engine asked me from Trabant Valve not to touch it, so I honored their request. So, but they also said that I could adjust on the Mikuni carburetor and move the main jet needle a little bit up so it would have more fuel, hoping that that will cure the detonation. So that's what we're gonna try now. We're gonna remove the front part, looks like a grill, and then we can get access to the carburetor.
When you remove this bolt here, that's what holding that front grill. There is a hole to hold this bolt, which is accidentally on the fuel tank right there. So in this way, you're not gonna lose it. So that's how you can take off the grill and then get access to the engine. Now that these two bolts are out, we can just simply pull it up and remove it. And now we can just place it up here. This is the fresh air valve that came off, a fresh air pipe. And then we can see the carburetor already down there. Here's this big pipe or hose or whatever it is. And then when we remove it, and it's actually a flexible part. So when we remove that, then we get access to the carburetor. Looks like if I take these two screws out, I can remove the whole thing. We'll try that. Using this really long screwdriver, I was able to loosen up the bolt. There's a flexible, a flexible pipe with a clamp around it, and I was able to loosen the clamp, then this whole thing came out. Then I was able to get to these two bolts, holding this plate on, and then I can pull this inner part out, and this is the one what we were after. I want to move this needle up one notch, so it will give just a hair more fuel, hoping that will cure the detonation. As you can see, I took it apart, and here's the little needle valve, the metering rod, and then here's the adjusting location on the top if it's ever focuses on. And then I can just move this clip to one down, therefore the whole thing as a neutral position will come one up, so therefore it will let more fuel into the engine. Gotta be careful with this adjustment, so we're just only gonna do one notch at a time, and then we're gonna try it up again. I've moved this one notch up, and then you gotta make sure that that plastic piece will slide in very nicely and covers up the end of the gas cable. And now I can install it back in. I can slide it back in, make sure you don't bend this metering rod, and then I can install the two screws on it, put it back in, tighten up the clamp, put this pipe back, and we can go try it again. The easiest way to do this, if you put your right hand through this hole, and then with your fingers, you find the bottom of the clamp, and then basically you have the screwdriver there with the other hand, and then when it's there, then you can actually properly unscrew it or screw it in, and it works really well this way.
Couldn't see that tank so dirty anymore, so I just cleaned it up a little bit. So now we are good to go. Let's try what it does.
Man, this engine is awesome. It got significantly better from that little adjustment. And now I don't hear any kind of detonation at the moment, but it's still kind of warming it up. But this thing almost as fast as my racing Trabant. This engine is great. Basically German engineering at its best, I would say. I know it's still a Trabant engine, but all the modern technology went in it to develop it and make it better. So Trabant Welt sells this engine. Let's see if it does anything up here. Nope. So far so good. Now there's a little sound now, but this thing is fast. Well, compared to other Trabants which I drove before. Love it. Yeah, it's still doing it. Now that it's came up to operating temperature and it's like 35 degrees Celsius outside, it's still I can kind of hear it. So yeah, I think it got better, but not totally cured. So maybe I can move that needle one more and then see if that fixes it. Or maybe I can go to the car parts store and try to find some octane booster. Maybe that would help. to mitigate this detonation problem.
Since we give up on the head gasket repair, now I'm gonna concentrate on the last thing what needs to be fixed. Last time I pushed it a little bit, but it wasn't enough. And this is this pipe, that exhaust pipe that goes from the back, or from the front to the back. Looks like this muffler is a little bit sideways as well. So I think there is a major bend in it. Fortunately, I have a sample for a race car. You can see how thicker that is than this little pipe what's on the car. But the size is the same. Basically, the diameter is different, but the bend is the same. So I'm gonna take it off and I'm gonna see where is it bent. Well, it looks like I just gotta push it in the middle, but I'm kind of scared to push it too hard, so make sure I'm not gonna break the front of the muffler. So I'm gonna remove this little clamp here and the clamp there, and I'm gonna take it apart, take it off, bend it, put it back together. The problem was that it was hitting right here, so I was able to move the whole system with this big screwdriver, but I supported the whole thing with this 2x4. It's actually made for exhaust repair. There's a V-shaped cut in it. And then I lifted up just a little bit with this hydraulic jack just to support this end of the exhaust system. I also removed the holder, so there is a support there, a little rubber bushing that holds the muffler system or the exhaust system. And I was able to very carefully move it with this long screwdriver. I had to be careful not to touch the brake line. It's like right next to it. And then I was able to move it down enough, so you can see it's not moving on the front. So I was able to move it down enough to get it done. So now I can reinstall the clamps, and then I think we're gonna be done with it. That's perfect. Everything else looks good other than the detonation in the engine. We'll find out what's gonna happen with that and how long it's gonna last. My German friends told me not to touch it, so this is what it got. They said it's gonna be fine. It's gonna be fine. So now just gonna put it back together, take it off the rack, and then we're gonna go fill it up, and then it's gonna be ready for Jean-Eric when he comes. The little chubby is ready for the journey. Today I'm gonna pick up Jean-Eric. He's gonna drive it across the US. And then a final thing I did is I did a cruise control for the chubby. It's really hard to hold the gas pedal, so I actually made a little block here where you can rest your foot and actually just push the gas pedal. I think it's a great idea. So we'll see how he likes it. I used to use a Coke bottle for that when I was driving across Europe, and it helped a lot because it's really hard for your foot to hold that really easy throttle. So let's see what tomorrow brings. My car club is coming out. My friend Mac is coming out. So we're all gonna say goodbye with all these classic cars to this little chubby. These are the things what I collected for him. A vintage cooler box, a case of two-stroke oil, and in order to mix the oil, I bought this because he grew up in metric, so as I did, and we're having a hard time thinking about gallons and ounces and stuff like that. So this one has the milliliters on the side. It's closable. It's like a water bottle. So this is how you're gonna measure out the oil, and I got a chart for him. So when he sticks the tank, he's gonna know how much is missing from it. So if the stick lever shows, let's say, 10 on the stick, then we know he needs to add 14 liter of fuel, and therefore that you need to put 280 milliliter of oil to it. So here's the 280 milliliter. He basically measures it out. It's not rocket science, and then just dump the oil in, fill it up with the rest, you know, because it's got 24 liters of the fuel tank capacity. So if he wants to do 1 to 40 mixture, it's on the right. I would recommend that going up on the mountains, and then 1 to 50 on the flatlands. And here are all the calculations, and this is how we should do it. So if you really want to see this, stop the video, and then you can make a copy of this, I guess. Because on the Trabi, there is a, instead of a fuel gauge, you have a measuring stick, and when you push that measuring stick down, it shows you how many liters remain in the tank. And then that's what you show on the left column. So I got a gallon of F-gas with a proper mixture already in there. I got him a four-place tent for the kids and the family when they come and they want to camp out in around Salt Lake City. I got him three sleeping bags because he's bringing his own, so this way the two kids and the wife gonna have enough. I got him San Pellegrino water, and I got the first aid kit. Is this actually an Airbus bag? And then inside I got one of these traveling first aid kit. I got one of these in case he breaks down in the desert. That's like a heat bag, so to hide away from the sun or something. I got him mosquito repellent and sunscreen because he might need that. He's got these flares in case he breaks down at nighttime. And I got him one of these hydrogen peroxide, so in case the kids cut themselves when they're camping. The kids and the family are coming later, so at the end of the tour. And then they're going to meet in Salt Lake City, as I understand, and then off they go from there. I have some octane booster, which really didn't really help too much, but I'm going to give it to him anyway. So if he goes up on the huge, large hills, maybe throw that in there. I got him a breaker bar if in case he needs to change a tire with a couple of pliers. All that came from O'Reilly's. O'Reilly's sells really good tools, by the way. And then this one, it's also if he needs to change the head gasket. And Trabant Welt sent him a package from Germany. It's like a support package. I don't know what's in it. Most likely some carburetors and other stuff, just in case you need to adjust stuff. So these are all the things I'm going to give him in the morning, and he's going to pack it up so he can see what he has. Good morning, just turn it off. So Jean-Eric has arrived. In style.
Yeah. Oh, it's such a nice car.
Okay. So welcome to America. How's it going?
I'm really happy to be here. Thanks Peter a lot for your motivation and your help, and I'm incredibly happy to be here.
Jean-Eric found my flying bicycle, so we're doing this arcade game right now instead of looking at cars. Jean-Eric wanted to drive one of the cars, so ask him which one. And of course he said the 56 Buick because that's the loudest. So let's see how it goes. So you can just push this one on. That one, yes.
Push it, yeah.
Turn it on.
Okay, yeah.
And then push the button. No, not that one. Push that one. What happens? Not that one. There's a rubber. There's a rubber one. You got to push that one.
Okay.
Add a little gas to it. So with your foot, you try to move it this way.
Yeah. Okay.
And then so now you can put it into drive. Yeah, pull it towards you, and it show you where the drive is. Okay, that's it, and let's go.
Okay.
And it's gonna wander all over the place. So it's like a boat.
Do we have a brake?
No, okay. We're just in a ditch.
Okay.
Let's go.
Yep.
You hung you on me. I think it sounds great.
Yes.
right, just keep going. It's a little dog, Tesla. Hello, Tesla. Good girl.
.322. Okay.
Not many.
But it sounds great. Relaxed. I have to drive on the road.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. Just go slow because it's gonna be.
Yes. Yep. You can drive down, yeah.
Yep. Just very slow. Vagyunk a dinerbe. More left, more left, more left. Yep. A little more. That's it.
Okay.
All right. And turn it off. This one off to the right.
Okay.
So what do you think?
Oh, I'm flashed. I'm incredibly happy. Such a cool car.
Yeah. That's a hay diner.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, pero. It's enough. I've pulled some of my cars out and invited the local Bourbon County cruisers to come wave goodbye to Jon-Erik as he embarks on his 4,000 miles journey across the United States. Have a good trip, Jon-Erik. And the Bourbon County cruisers are departing. Thank you guys for coming out. And also, thank you for watching. And see you guys next Friday with something else. Bye.